The Battle Frontier in Pokemon Emerald has to be one of the most challenging experiences Pokemon has to offer. And I've already beaten it. Or, well, most of it anyway. You see, I've done all the single player content it has to offer, and I've only done the single battle challenges within that. So that's why when my friend Tamahiro asked me if I wanted to do the Battle Tower multi-battle challenge, I was extremely excited. I've never done this before, and neither has she, I don't think, so it would be a fun experience. If you don't know, you can actually link up with a friend and do double battles in the Battle Tower together. You each get to bring two Pokemon, and none of the four Pokemon can be the same species or have the same items. To help with this challenge, I'll need some pretty good Pokemon. Most people will settle on a Pokemon with the right nature and maybe one or two perfect IVs, which is usually good enough. But me, I'm a bit of a perfectionist. I am obsessed with getting 5 or 6 IV Pokemon for these challenges or for a competitive play. But the problem is, all of my Pokemon are level 100, and we agreed to do the level 50 Battle Tower, so I would need some new Pokemon. After we decided on the team, a Zapdos and Swampert for me, and a Tauros and Latias for her, I set off to work acquiring my team. I'll also keep track of how long everything takes me to do. I figured it would be fun to show how fast glitches can make things in tandem with RNG manips in Pokemon Emerald. And it's here we face our first obstacle already. I have several Fire Reds and a Japanese Leaf Green, and Pokemon XD, but I've caught all the Zapdos and all of them already. Do I really have to replay one of them just for one Zapdos? Nope, and it's all thanks to Odin's horse Sleipnir, because I'll be respawning Zapdos using arbitrary code execution. The setup for this is very complex, so I won't go into too much detail here. Please check out Sleipnir's video on it if you want to do this yourself. But the short of it is, I have a Crobat with a glitch move on it that, when used, points the program counter to the names of my Pokemon boxes, and it reads them as if they were ARM Assembly, which is the GBA's processor. So I just name the boxes a specific set of characters, and when I use the glitch move, they will respawn Zapdos. So now I've got my Zapdos back. On top of that, I figured it would be neat to get this Zapdos shiny as well. Shininess in these games is determined by exclusive ORing your trainer ID and secret ID against the Pokemon you caught's PID. And if the remainder is less than 8, it's a shiny. Your secret ID is a normally hidden 5-digit value that is the second half of your trainer ID, and a Pokemon's PID is an 8-digit hex value that is also typically hidden. So how do we know both of these things? Well, for the secret ID, that's the neat part. We don't. I am just going to use another set of box codes and Crobat's glitch move to change it so that the PID I want is going to be shiny. And the PID, well, I know what it will be because of a little thing called RNG manipulation. I'll be controlling the random number generator, aka what determines the luck that happens in these games, to get my desired Pokemon. Fire Red and Emerald both use what's known as a linear congruential generator as their pseudo-random number generator, which is an algorithm that takes in an input, does some math to it, and gives the end user an output that looks random. This means that if we know the initial input, we can predict the output with a special calculator known as Gen 3 Seed Assistant, and we will know exactly what Pokemon will spawn and when. In Fire Red's case, it's when you hit A on the title screen. Pressing A here causes the GBA to pull some data from one of its internal CPU registers, and it uses that to seed the LCG algorithm. The timing for this A press is very strict, as the GBA checks this register every time a video frame is rendered, aka every 1/60th of a second. The initial seed that gets pulled from the register is determined by a bunch of various factors, such as your speaker setting, your L button setting, and what button you use to continue on the title screen. Because of this, we can't just calculate what initial seed will be when, we have to manually search for them. Fed up with manual work, my friend Xiao and I have recorded thousands of initial seeds by using my homemade GameCube controller, a capture card, arbitrary code execution, and Python automatically. This gives me lots of options to choose from as far as initial seeds go. After the initial seeding, the game runs the LCG RNG every video frame. Because of this, my Pokemon will be determined by a 1/60th of a second window timing for when I press A to encounter it. This means to succeed at this RNG manip, I have to hit the 1/60th of a second window 2 times consecutively. This is very difficult, so we have special timers and calculators that beep rhythmically to help us keep our time and adjust when we are off on our timing. This takes tons of skill, patience, and practice. The process to get the Zapdos is to copy my seed list and put it into the Gen 3 Seed Assistant program, and then also tell the program what Zapdos I want in terms of its stats and their natures. I want a modest Zapdos with Hidden Power Grass 70 and as many perfect stats as I can get on it. I decided on HP Grass because my Swampert will be running Ice Beam, so I don't need HP Ice on Zapdos, and we otherwise lack grass coverage. Gen 3 Seed Assistant will then tell me the closest initial seed to my desired stat spread, and I can check the seed list to see how long I have to wait on the title screen to hit that seed. Gen 3 Seed Assistant also tells me how long I have to wait after the initial seed is selected. After that, I use Pokefinder to help figure out what secret ID I will need to make this Zapdos shiny, and I change mine to that using arbitrary code execution. Now it's time to RNG. I put all the timing info into Flowtimer, which helps me press A at the right time. After an hour of attempts, it shows up, but I've got my 5 IV shiny modest Zapdos with Hidden Power Grass 70. This is one of the coolest parts of RNG for me. This Zapdos would be impossible to get otherwise, and I didn't have to hack or mod my game to do it. Through patience and practice, I was able to learn a skill that lets me get something you'd have to otherwise pull a slot machine for probably ever. After that, I'll be needing my Mudkip. So I boot up Emerald to do another RNG minute. You might be thinking that I'd turn to breeding, but you'd be wrong. Pray to our Norse horse Sleipnir again, because I'll be using arbitrary code execution to respawn the starter bag, and I'll just be choosing a new starter while in the post game. It works the same as Fire Red, but instead of a glitch move, we view a glitch Pokemon's glitch animation. So I rename the boxes and respawn the Mudkip. After that, it's RNG time. I didn't make this Mudkip shiny, mostly because I was sort of running out of time. Anyway, Emerald's RNG works very similar to Fire Red's. It uses the same LCG PRNG algorithm, and it advances this RNG at 60 frames per second. The main difference is its initial seeding function. Emerald doesn't do anything. Programmers commented out the Fire Red initial seeding function, intending to use Emerald's internal battery and date and time to seed this game, but they forgot to implement it, meaning Emerald's initial seed is always the same, zero. Luckily, we have a workaround for this. For reasons unknown to both man and god, when you view the paintings in the Pokemon Contest Hall, the initial seeding function is called. This time, it seeds based on how many video frames have been rendered since the game has been booted. The GBA renders a new video frame every 1/60th of a second, so it's the same precision as FireRed's initial seeding. After some searching, I decide I want to aim for a quiet Mudkip on seed A7E, which is about a 2600 frame wait, aka 43 seconds. On this seed, the Mudkip I want is at around 55,000 advances, which is a long time. However, unlike Fire Red, this is not a double frame perfect trick. The reason this is not a double frame perfect trick is because we can use battle records. So, once I hit my seed using the painting, I confirm it by going and catching a Pokemon in Victory Road and checking its IVs. After that, I fly to the battle frontier, go into the battle factory, and lose a match. The key is that after losing the match, I save the record of the battle on my trainer pass. This is a replay of the match I've just had. This is useful because the GBA doesn't store a video recording of the match or anything like that. It stores the teams, the move selections, and the exact RNG state. So all the luck perfectly matches up to what happened. Because of this, I can save my exact seed so I don't have to do it again. At this point, I wait about 50,000 frames and make another battle record, so I'm reasonably close to Mudkip. Yeah, this is like a 15-minute wait, but I only have to do it once thanks to the battle records. After all the battle record stuff is done, I save in front of the briefcase and run my attempts. With good timing, I get my perfect quiet Mudkip. All in all, from respawn to RNG, it took about an hour and 15 minutes to get this Mudkip. After a quick trade, I've got my Zapdos and Mudkip into my proper Emerald. Now I've got the two perfect Pokemon here, what do I do with them? Well, Eevee train, of course. I actually had to train both of these Pokemon completely differently, so we'll go over Mudkip first, and then we'll talk about Zapdos. For Mudkip, I wanted its final Eevee spread to be 152 HP, 252 attack, and 100 special attack, as a sort of naturally bulky offensive tank that could hit on either side of the defense spectrum. So I first gave it 10 HP ups, 10 proteins, and 10 calcium. This meant that I had 100 EVs in each of these stats. Vitamins are expensive, but Emerald has a few handy-dandy cloning glitches. So I just get one of each of these vitamins, and using the item clone glitch, I can clone dozens of every item I need without consequence or money. After the vitamins, I use Pokemon KOs to finish up the EV training. First, I did attack. The way Pokemon KOs work is that every Pokemon grants a specific amount of EVs based on their species when you KO them. I then enhance this with PokeRust and the Macho Bracer, which both double the amount of EVs I gain on KO, and they stack together. The Macho Bracer is given to you by the Windstraits after you defeat them, and I got PokeRust by performing Glitcher Popping, which usually just gives some of the bad exit spawns PokeRust, which can be passed on to a normal Pokemon. There's one more neat trick too, and it's Ditto. It actually gives the EVs of whatever it's transformed into when you KO it instead of whatever Ditto normally gives. This is useful because typical wild Pokemon only give 1 or 2 EVs, which, with the Macho Bracer and Pokerus, would only give us 4 or 8 EVs respectively. But some rarer Pokemon give 3 EVs on KO, which would give us 12 EVs with the Bracer and Pokerus. And I utilize this for attack, so I head into the Desert Underpass and I lead with Mudkip. Once I get into a battle with Ditto, I switch into my Groudon, who grants 3 attack EVs on KO, and Ditto uses Transform as I switch. Then, I outspeed and KO it with Solar Beam. My Groudon will always outspeed Ditto, because it gets a 10% boost in speed from the badge boost mechanic, and Ditto doesn't copy that. Then, Solar Beam is always a one-turn move because of Drought. I KO 12 Groudons this way to get to 244 attack. Then, I take off the Macho Brace and KO one more, and I'm at 250. Lastly, I KO one Shuppet to get to 252 attack. For HP, I use Meryl instead of Ditto. They spawn outside of the daycare in a pond, and they grant 2 EVs per KO and have a 100% spawn rate. The 100% spawn rate in combination with 2 EVs per KO is the reason they're a bit faster than the Ditto trick, because Ditto only has a 50% spawn rate. I just have to KO 6 Meryl and I'm done with Mudkip's EVs. After that, I spam rare candies that I obtained via cloning, so he's at level 50. I kept him from evolving until he learned Hydro Pump at level 42, then gave him the 3 TMs he needed, which were Ice Beam, Protect, and Earthquake, all also cloned many times, so I have as many as I need. I also need to fill them all up with PP Maxes, which I also cloned, so the moves can be used the max number of times. All of that literally took 22 minutes. Because I don't have to farm for money, TMs, vitamins, or level grind, the only chore really is just KOing the Pokemon. With the little guy done, we move on to D-Cell. This is actually going to be a little bit tricky. You see, let's say you're in Gen 6, 7, or 8, and you want to participate in the level 50 Battle Tower or equivalent. You could just put any Pokemon in there, and it would automatically lower your Pokemon to level 50 temporarily while you're in the challenge. But in Emerald, nope. If you are one level over 50, it becomes ineligible for the level 50 Battle Tower. So I have to fully EV train the Zapdos, which is at level 50, because that's the level I caught it at, while also making sure it never hits level 51. I'm just doing a simple max speed, max special attack set. I actually set up Zapdos moves first. And by that I mean I give it hidden power and a PP max to all of its moves, because I'm keeping the rest of its base learn set, which is Thunderbolt, Thunder Wave, and Drill Peck. So the way I ended up EVing Zapdos was to first give it 10 Carbos and 10 Calcium for speed and special attack, and then finding the lowest level Pokemon that would spawn reliably for those two stats. For speed, this was Zubat and Altering Cave, who would give about 115 EXP per KO and 1 EV each. For special attack, this was Spinda and Slugma on Route 113, who gave around 200 EXP each, and both of these Pokemon would give 4 EVs each if I was using Pokerus and the Macho Bracer. This actually wouldn't have been enough though, but I cut the EXP gain even more by using Switch Training. You see, even though Zapdos was more than powerful enough to KO all these Pokemon on its own, I would lead with it and then switch to my Rayquaza instead to KO the Pokemon. This splits the EXP between both of them, making Zapdos gain EXP even slower. I had to KO 38 Zubat and 38 Spinda this way, and then I gave my Zapdos an HP up to round off its EVs. The end result was a pretty tedious training session, but 53 minutes later, I had a Zapdos that was fully trained and still level 50. Oh, and also a weird thing about these games. EVs do not get applied right away. Typically, they apply when a Pokemon levels up. That's why when you're training, you'll see a huge plus 5 or something like that to a specific stat that you're happen to be training. But they also apply if you deposit a Pokemon into the PC. If I don't put Zapdos in the PC and take it out before going to the Battle Tower, it'd be the same thing as using a Zapdos that isn't EV trained. And with that, we're all done. All in all, it took me 3.5 hours to catch and train these two goons. Pretty swift, especially for such an old game. If this was a full team of 6, it'd have taken me 7 hours, which is light speed compared to some of the stuff that I've done. Now it's time to connect to Tama and do our matches. Our goal was to get 50 wins, since the tower awards ribbons at that point, and there's no other rewards for continuing past this. But how did we connect? We didn't meet up in person. Well, in short, we connected over the internet using an emulator and the program Parsec. Stay tuned on Tama's channel, as she'll have a video there in detail about how we connected. While you're there, please check out one of her awesome video essays on Pokemon or any of the other games she's talked about. They're all awesome. Anyway, in preparation for the connection, I backed up my Pokemon Emerald ROM and save file using my GBX rewritable, so this is all totally legit. And then we linked up. The entire stream was on her Twitch channel and the VOD is still up, but here's some highlights of the run.
Okay. I really hope this KOs. You are a very strong bird. Alright, Walrein's bulky, but I don't know how bulky.
Oh, it has a focus sash.
Oh, focus, it's focus band. No, focus band. That's only like 10%.
The percent of that's like 10% or something.
Yeah, but in this mode, 10% is like guaranteed it's gonna do it.
It's guaranteed.
If it's them. Yeah. Especially two ice beamers versus Latias.
Okay. Yeah, I'm fine.
Alright. Nope, you're frozen. All right. Oh no. What is your guy holding?
Lefties.
Latias versus Tauros.
They're not gonna get another attack this turn as well. It's just gonna be Tauros attack. Hopefully he attacks me.
Oh my god, it does have double team.
God. Why god?
Oh good. Twice. Okay, cool. Phew. Whew. I mean, that wasn't the worst possible situation, but it wasn't great.
Dude, I mean, we were in there until the freeze happened. I'll say that much. I'm going to Thunderbolt Charizard, and you can take me out of this existence.
With return.
Amnesia.
Oh, it's trying to counter your strategy.
That's going to work out well when I Thunderbolt Octillery.
Oh, wait, it raised Relicanth's special defense.
No, Relicanth used it.
Oh, I thought Octillery did. I got confused.
No, Octillery just came in, because there was something else there. I forget what it was. It was a water type.
Oh, good point. I Thunderbolted something. Good point.
I Thunderbolted something to death.
It was a giant Kingler.
Oh, it was the big Kingler. That's right. We are the same. What is... The brains are just fried. We should be faster than both of them. Although, Mens could be faster than me, but...
Maybe we'll order dinner. So I don't know. I guess we'll have to ask Chaz what he wants.
Oh my lord. Wait. Oh, you got intimidated.
Oh, that's right. The Salamence.
Another Neither of us were paying attention.
No, I'm thinking about food now. I think we'll still be okay.
But yeah, I think we'll be alright. I'm not super concerned. I'm a little more concerned now, actually, I'll say it.
Because you think it'll be faster now?
Then you... Yeah, it's 100 speed. If it's got any speed investment, it could... Oh, Lord.
Okay, now I'm worried.
Oh, that's going to do a lot of damage. That is going to KO my Zapdos, I think.
Uh-oh.
Oh, Lord, it didn't. All right, let's go. D-cell, goaded.
Kill yourself? No. Nope.
That's fine. D-bolt's going to KO. What?
We got here. Yay! That's it. We're done.
We did it.
We're finally done.
Oh, man.
That was a good afternoon, evening, morning.
Yeah.
It was a lot. It was pretty much all day.
No thanks, I'm going to sleep. That's me. The entire run was a blast, and thanks again to Tama for asking me to do this with her. Yeah, our brains were mostly sludge after 5 hours of streaming, but we got to 50 wins, and my Zapdos and Swampert got their ribbon. I hope you all enjoyed this mini little team builder, and thank you so much for watching. I'll see you all next time. I hope everybody enjoyed the video. I have more coming in Scarlet and Violet, so I hope you're excited for that. With that said, I want to give a big special shout out to my YouTube channel members. Thank you guys so much. Your generosity and your support is unbelievable. I couldn't continue making videos like this without all of you. I want to do a special shout out to my Blissy tier members, AB Twisty and Fragiles, and an even bigger shout out to my Bliss God tier members, RLIZT and ShadowBlitz56. Your generosity is unbelievable. Thank you so, so much. If you want to become a channel member, you can hit the join button down below. It's as low as $1.99 a month, and it gets you access to a special server in my Discord, my videos early, the challenges VODs for this, so you can see me do all of it live as if I was streaming, and so much more. Thank you so much. See you guys later.